podcast for grown-ups, so there may be grown-up language. So there, you've been warned. Welcome to Gay Nerd Love.
This is what we talk about when we're not doing it. I'm Archie.
And I'm Andy, and we're streaming to you live from Portland, Oregon.
You can hear us live every Saturday from 12 to 12:45 Pacific time. And this is actually only 9 more episodes before the end of the show.
Yes.
Yeah. And that means we will be off the air for good in 9 more shows. So let's
get in. Because you said so.
Because producer. We have other projects that we'll touch on later in this podcast. But yeah, it will be time to move on from this and to other things.
And what are we going to move on to today?
Well, we have breaking news. We don't have a bumper like. But some shows back, we talked about. We actually had a guest to
yes.
discuss the fan film Star Trek Axanar, mm-hmm. and the lawsuit by CBS Paramount to halt production of their movie because right. they were infringing upon the copyrights owned by. By CBS Paramount.
That was what they were charging, yes.
Yes. They filed a motion to dismiss. The motion was denied.
Axanar
a motion to dismiss. It was denied pretty swiftly, like within a week or two. And the latest news, as I don't think it's even 24 hours old, is that Paramount has not dropped the lawsuit. A lot of online sites are claiming that this lawsuit was dropped, but the statement is actually it was settled.
Which is a very different... interpretation, very important distinction.
It's like in the process of being settled. So they're going to, part of that settlement is they're going to set out fan film guidelines.
Right.
For future Star Trek related productions. And the announcement was made by J.J. Abrams and Justin Lin, the director of the new Star Trek Beyond.
From the stage of, I believe, Comic-Con, right? Where they're, I think that's where it's making its like pre-premiere or something. There's like a sneak preview happening there.
Oh, was it Comic-Con? It's some Star Trek event for sure.
Yeah, because Star Trek Beyond premieres on July 22nd. So it's just now, I guess, starting to be out there for some sneak previews. But in the age of the internet, news or whatever breaks really fast and oftentimes a lot of stuff gets out there that is wrong. So this is really brand new information. We really don't know the details on this. But you're right. It does sound like it's already getting misinterpreted as, oh, it's been settled, so therefore the movie's going forward. We don't know that, right?
Right. And as if, you know, what we talked about, we're talking about the difference between being dropped and mm-hmm. being settled. Drops like, oh, sorry.
Go ahead.
No worries.
We don't mind.
Just do whatever you want.
Versus, okay, we won't sue your ass, but...
You have permission to use these characters or this content in this particular way in your project.
Or please don't sue us. We're not going to do anything except that. I mean, it depends on which direction you're looking at it from. You know, I mean, we don't know who decided to settle with whom. We're assuming it's Paramount who's settling. But that's an assumption again.
Yes. Again, back to the director of Star Trek Beyond, Justin Lin. Apparently, he was instrumental in getting
right.
Paramount to stop.
Which is interesting.
The legal...
And that he did it apparently as a Star Trek fan, not as a director.
As a Star Trek fan, right. He says.
This is interesting.
This is not a way to treat fans. I'm paraphrasing the quote, but it's all over the net now. So,
we'll put the video that we found of it up. But what I find interesting is, until that moment, I've been very cynical about the upcoming movie, about it being directed by someone who directed a Fast and Furious movie, and that horrible sabotage... song underlying, you know, trailer we've seen.
It just
looked like an action movie instead of a Star Trek movie.
Star Trek Fast and Furious.
Right. But now to find out, oh, is Justin Lin actually a real hardcore fan? More so than J.J. Abrams, who just, I guess the other day, or maybe it was in this weekend or whatever, during, I think, the same Comic-Con appearance, said that he was kind of catching up, that he hadn't been a childhood fan of Star Trek, to which I tweeted when I retweeted that thing. I said, yeah, it shows. I hate what J.J. Abrams has done with the two movies of Star Trek so far. I can't say that enough. And I'm very cynical about what he has done, and I'm very, very upbeat on non-J.J. Abrams things going forward. But I am anxious also to see that fan films continue to get made and that Axanar... Exner has a great concept and a really, really bunch of really talented people.
It looks very professional.
It's just,
yes.
It's so professional, it looks like it's the kind of thing that is going to get sued because it's like, no, this is not a fan film.
This is not canon.
Well, not just canon, but it's no, this is actually somebody trying to make a Star Trek film without using Paramount.
Well, they built a studio with the crowdfunding
which they received. Which we talked about. And the crowdfunding thing is another issue that seems to be kind of still a sore wound, that it will be interesting to see if the lawsuit settlement takes into account the fact that a whole bunch of people gave money to make this happen. What's going to happen with that money?
Well, that's what'll unfold in the coming weeks. You just made me think of something. Probably there could be a possibility that some of the terms of the settlement are that you cannot use our intellectual property to raise money.
To
their credit, they've since taken it down. But I mean,
the
Axanar people. They were selling coffee with Star Trek logos on it.
Now,
like
when you say Star Trek logos, you're talking about the Axanar logo, right? Not the Star Trek logo.
The Axanar logo.
Okay.
But the yes.
To be clear.
They're selling models of ships also.
That's not Paramount intellectual property. I think it's really important in the context of a legal battle to talk about intellectual property, to know what is intellectual property.
But they were also selling models of ships, what they stopped doing,
right,
too.
Okay.
And those models were taken adapted from designs that are owned by
Star Trek.
See,
that's where
it gets
interesting. If I take a kit,
right,
if I take a model kit of an Enterprise D,
sure,
and I fashion, or even if I take the design three-dimensionally in a 3D computer simulation, and then I create my own starship, at what point does it stop being intellectual property of Paramount or of whomever designed it for Paramount? And at what point does it become my design?
I would think at the...
And maybe, you know, these are questions that we should ask a lawyer.
But we're not lawyers, but it's fun to speculate.
I'm asking, you know, that...
At the point where it cannot, by a reasonable person, be confused with the intellectual property of Paramount.
Which,
I'm just saying.
Right. Well, which begs the question, does that mean that any starship that has two nacelles on it owned by Paramount?
Nacelles of that particular design?
There's been six or seven different nacelle designs,
sure,
you know, going all the
and
way
And we
back
own
to
them
that.
All, goddammit.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I don't know if you can... I know you can... You can't copyright titles.
No.
But you can trademark things.
Right.
Which is different. Star Trek is trademarked, as I found out when I created a porn Star Trek t-shirt. And I gave it to a friend of mine, I cannot say his name, who works in the industry, who has worked in Star Trek, and said, yeah, a lot of people's eyebrows went up because it was like, really, where did you get that? Because that's like the kind of thing that Paramount would totally frown on, would totally not, that's why he wore it. So,
well, dialing back to another one of our podcasts, when we talked about the Star Trek porn film, they were very careful not to use, not even Starfleet insignia.
Right.
On any of the uniforms,
right,
or any, you know. So,
and I don't remember what the ship looked like.
I don't remember the ship looked like at all.
But they put the word parody on everything, though, too.
Yes.
And that's where they hide behind that, because there's that blank, 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 a blank, an XXX parody, which is how they did a Married with Children XXX parody. There's been all these porn parodies. So I think that gets into a slightly different realm.
But the question you asked is very good. And fans and friends, this is something to chew on, especially if you're big Star Trek nuts like we are, because we were just watching Star Trek before we came on the air.
Mm-hmm.
At what point does a design, like say a ship, not become – I mean, is it considered original and not part of the Paramount intellectual property?
Because almost all fan stuff is derived –
sure –
from original material. So you really it I don't know. And I think that the reason this is now more important than it used to be is that there's a distribution mechanism that didn't used to exist. The internet is why this is now important to Paramount. Although my understanding is that Paramount was cracking down on everything.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Before. Even before the internet, they were like really, really – it's just that they couldn't find it because it was actually being passed hand to hand rather than over the internet.
And I don't want to
– that's my understanding.
Go too far into this, but
sure,
you know, things come up as we talk about it. The whole look and feel issue, we talked about when does it become
right
original and – excuse me, when it's an original design and when it's infringing.
And we discussed that in the episode about Axanar itself, where we kind of started out on one side going, oh my God, this is great, we hope this gets made, and then kind of looking into it going, well, no, maybe.
I can kind of see their point.
Yeah. And it's interesting that I just learned like half an hour ago in doing a web search for something else that Tony Todd, who was in the trailer, the teaser trailer that they made for Axanar.
And he played Worf's brother, the Klingon.
He's been in a lot of Star. He's been in several Star Trek episodes. That he's now on the short list for the new official Star Trek reboot TV series in 2017.
And he had recently left the Axanar production because he was quoted saying he didn't like the way it was. Yeah, again, I'm paraphrasing. I don't remember, but basically he didn't like the way the production was being handled, so he left.
Right,
that was his statement.
So that's interesting.
So, after this, are you still looking forward to Axanar?
I want it to get made. Yeah,
yeah, I do.
I don't want it to rip anybody off.
Yes.
Is what I'm saying. But I also don't want it. I don't want there to be a chilling effect on fan fiction or the freedom of people in fandom to appreciate and create their own material, so long as it is not for personal profit. And so far as I know, that's always been the loophole or the way that you can do it. And if the people who are making Axanar are trying to do something that's much closer to a production, I completely understand Paramount's point. So we'll see. We'll see when we get more details. If we have more details by next weekend, you know, we'll update.
And we'll be right back after this short message. This episode of Gay Nerd Love is brought to you by our friends at Second Look Scripts, an independent professional editing service that helps you make your writing stand out. Second Look Scripts will edit and proofread your writing for just a penny per word. That's it. Go to secondlookscripts.com and enter the offer code GNLPDX to get 10% off of your first edit.
Maybe Second Look Scripts can like give the Axanar script a second look.
Well, you know, even
and
though,
Tony Todd can come back.
Even though we were kind of wrapping it up now, of course you bring questions. I wonder if they're going to have to do a major rewrite based upon these new guidelines to.
I'm trying not to speculate because we don't even know if this means the show's going forward.
I love speculating.
Right.
It's gossip.
I want to speculate when I know what the terms of the settlement are.
Sure. Because okay.
I think until then it's kind of like wasted time.
All right. So
I'm not trying to shut you down, but
it's
but
okay.
I,
no,
but I
no,
did.
No, it's fine. Well, let's move on.
Speaking of track,
let's move on to this. Now, I found out from you that a teaser for the new CBS series, online series, has been released.
Yeah, the new streaming series Star Trek, which is being helmed by Brian Fuller, who is a college chum of mine. Full disclosure. Also, he was a writer on Star Trek Deep Space Nine, wrote a lot of episodes, and co-produced on Voyager. Is a very talented writer. He is the genius behind Hannibal, which was a fantastic show. I was so thrilled when I heard that he was doing this new show, which premieres in 2017 and is going to be kind of the flagship show of the new CBS All Access streaming series, kind of like CBS doing their own kind of Netflix, I guess, or some kind of like Amazon Prime, I guess, is probably a better example.
So everyone gets to watch the pilot, and if you want to,
yes.
If you want to see any other episodes, you have to pay
for it. Which is a smart idea. It's like, mm-hmm. We'll give you this for free.
It's
we'll
like a drug dealer. I'll
right.
give you I give you a
exactly.
taste, and then you got
it. Totally. And I was just looking into it. It's going to cost like $6 a month, so it's like nothing. So it's going to be, you know, even if the only reason you want to, even if the only reason that you subscribe to CBS Access, $6 a month is worth it for, I'm assuming it's going to be weekly episodes or something. But anyway, they put the new trailer online. It was, when I heard, oh, there's a new teaser, I'm sorry, teaser, not trailer.
Yes.
Teaser online. I went, really? Already? So I immediately, of course, you know, went to it online and looked at it. I was like, oh, that really is a teaser.
A teaser does not have to tell you anything about it.
But then I saw a post on Brian Fuller's Facebook page saying that they're warning Easter eggs may be found. And I was like, Easter
okay.
eggs? Wow. Now,
see, I sat next to you and watched the thing.
Mm-hmm.
So let's mm-hmm. talk about Easter eggs.
Well,
exactly what
let's
they are.
Start with the definition of an Easter egg.
Right.
What do you consider an Easter egg to be in the context of DVDs and in the context of films and movies and teasers? And
oh,
trailers?
Okay. For me, in context of DVDs, I used to look for Easter eggs. I used to be like an Easter egg. I was on an Easter egg hunt for like 6 months. I would get DVDs just to find out Easter eggs. And really, they're usually in the menu. and you have to find them. And when you find the Easter egg, it gives you extra content.
So
behind the scenes, you know, stuff that's not part of the main movie or whatever. It's just stuff
right.
that supports it.
My understanding of an Easter egg in the first use,
something hidden.
In the first use of that term was not just something hidden, something that you had to use a mechanical control to access that was outside of the material that you were looking at.
Well, that's a better way of saying
it.
It was not
just like a poster in the background in the movie or something. In other words, it wasn't in the material you were watching on screen. It was something that you had to get to electronically. That was what I understood an Easter egg to mean.
Yeah.
So if you're watching a teaser trailer or whatever, I don't see how you can use it as you can call it an Easter egg, unless that's a term that's now being broadened.
Maybe it is, because now that I'm thinking
about it.
Just
mean hidden things.
Because maybe comic book movies talk about Easter eggs in their trailers. And so I think, as you're saying, Easter eggs are now broadening it to mean hidden things and not something you search around for with your remote on your DVD.
Because in the trailer, which we'll post a link to or whatever, they're basically...
Teaser.
The teaser, I'm sorry, because that's a very important distinction. I can't wait to see the first trailer. We won't have a trailer until we have footage, of course. But the teaser that we're given this week basically seems to be a flyby of two astronomical bodies. One of them looks like a blue, icy, half-destroyed planet, very plasmic.
Like a frozen planet.
Like a frozen planet that's been shattered.
Then a volcanic planet.
And then it seems to go, no, the next one seems to be a star or a sun because there's something orbiting it.
Oh,
there is
okay.
a body orbiting it. And there's already fan speculation that the first one is a reference to Praxis, the moon that explodes at the beginning of Star Trek VI, which was the last film to feature the entire original series crew, and the sun with the planet going around it that looks like it's kind of like exploding or doing something refers to, I can't remember the name of the star, but it's the star that blows up in Star Trek Generations, which was the first Next Generation film. So what they're extrapolating is, they're saying, does this hint that the next Star Trek series is going to take place in the universe, in the time span between those two events? And I can see extrapolating that.
But that's hardly an Easter egg.
I guess that's what they call an Easter egg now. I mean, maybe I should just call Brian Fuller on the phone and say, what do you mean by Easter egg, or are you just fucking with us?
Fans should, like, pressure him on Twitter to say...
Oh, they probably have.
What? Because everything we read...
Explain. Disclose the information.
Everything we read about other people's, you know, breakdown of this teaser, it was all speculation. I think this may mean, this may mean, this could mean, that kind of thing.
Not an Easter egg. Now, I know what a sadistic fuck Brian Fuller is. There may be absolutely nothing. He may be simply posting that to get the internet to catch fire and be just like micro looking over things. And God bless Brian for doing that, because that's brilliant marketing.
I just had a thought, which would be a true Easter egg.
What?
If you went, and I'm sure some nerds out there have done this.
What?
If you go through the teaser frame by frame,
yeah.
And in a piece of exploding asteroid, there's a transparent image of an alien or a ship.
There's
or something like
already
that.
A screen grab that shows a really small thing of something and compares it to one of the shots of the Voyager ship from the Voyager credit sequence and say, is this look familiar?
Oh.
So it's already the possibility somebody's already found a ship. So somebody's already doing
in the
what
pieces
they're doing.
Of the
in the pieces or whatever.
Wow,
that
is so
by.
Deep.
So yes,
I can't do that. I can't go. That far.
I mean, I was asking you earlier. I was like, is there a program or an application I can get that can take HD video and shatter it into individual frames, and you can then, because it's high definition, you can go and really blow stuff up.
I wonder how much memory that would take, though.
Oh. It would probably take all weekend to render, I'm assuming. But
you must really want to get those six
you know,
single frames of
whatever. I mean, I'm glad. I'm glad that this getting. I'm glad it's getting promoted. I'm glad, even if this is a stunt, then bravo, Brian. Bravo, Paramount. Get everybody jazzed up and excited about seeing this. One of the other things that was discussed as being an Easter egg And I think that here's where the terms are really stretch, I think, to call it this, is the logo, the font that's being used. Well, first of all.
So the brushed metallic.
Not just that. The Starfleet logo.
Right.
If you'll notice, in the last shot of the teaser, has a line running down the middle.
Huh.
Or off to the side. Now, somebody pointed out that that looks a lot like a Starfleet logo that I think was used in an episode either about the future or something similar to that. But I was just thinking, this very moment, I was
in an episode of which?
Of Next Generation.
Oh, okay.
I think it was in the episode where Riker thinks that he's awakened 20 years in the future, and it turns out he's actually in the cave with a little boy who's just making the holodeck thing happen.
That's one of my favorites.
The one with Minuet, who turns out to be his wife, and it's like, wait a minute.
That kid's a great actor in that one, too.
I think that was where that logo first showed up as being the future Federation logo, which might imply that this is a Next Gen episode, or it might imply, now this was something I just now thought about as I was starting to form these sentences. What if it is an indication of a split in the Federation, like a civil war, which seems to be the whole du jour among comics and among everybody's fighting everybody now.
Well, that goes back to that theory, the theory we had yet again in an earlier show, where that the patrol ship
for what
in the new series there was, didn't you say that the new ship was a patrol ship patrolling?
We were speculating.
Oh,
remember we were planning out the whole series with Angela Bassett in charge and Jodie Foster playing an admiral.
Where did I get that it was a patrol ship from somewhere? Anyway, okay,
no, that's not official. That's not canon.
Okay,
we were just going out and saying, well, this is what we would do. give us a shot, Brian. We'll write you some spec scripts.
So, yes. Well, if there are hidden images. I'll just wait for someone to find them and post them.
No, I'm not. That's for the kids. Let the kids do that with their computers.
Let the kids do that. Yeah, while
with their IMAX. But no, I mean, I just suddenly thought that would be an interesting kind of, it's been staring us right in the face all along, simply the fact that there's a crack or that there's actually that the Federation logo is in two pieces.
Mm.
Now, maybe somebody else has already thought of this. That's really kind of obvious. The other thing that somebody pointed out was that the font that's being used for Star Trek, which, by the way, has caused a big, like, oh, I hate it, oh, I love it, you know, Twitter war going on, of course. Somebody pointed out that it is kind of a style that harkens back to the old original series font and the new one, which, again, could imply that this is a show that bridges the period between the original series time and the Next Generation timeline. That this is going to fill in that gap. Because that seems to be the wildest, the biggest interest people have. Is not only who's going to be in it, but also what time frame, what universe is this going to take place
in? Well, now when you're saying Tony Todd and the fact that it could be bridged Next Gen and the new one. And the first thing I thought with that new font and the, you know, the I guess you could say brushed silver.
Mm-hmm. Or brass.
Brass. No. And all the angles cutting into the letters. It made me think of a knife. And the next thing I thought of was Klingon.
Yes.
Right?
In fact, if you look at the Star Trek logo, gentle listener, in fact, we're using the word star out of the new Star Trek logo for our Facebook cover page. It does have a Klingon-esque look.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, who
knows? So this could be the story between what?
Between Kittimer. The Kimmer Conference, which was the end in Star Trek VI, where it was like, will we make peace?
Mm-hmm.
And Star Trek Next Generation, where we're standing on the bridge in the first, few hours of the show.
Oh, no. I just thought of something horrible.
What?
What if Star Trek Beyond has to shoehorn some way to connect to the series
It could be kind of like... Well, now, wait a minute. It could be kind of like Paramount to want to do that just for the sake of synergy. But I think, I hope I'm not just projecting here. I think I read somewhere that one of the few things that Brian Fuller has already revealed about the show is that it is not going to take place in the J.J. Abrams Star Trek universe.
Okay.
Which
okay,
is
fine.
A big, I think I'm remembering that only because it was a great relief and excitement for me. It was like, oh, thank God this is going to stay true to the original universe, not what I'm considering to be this kind of apocryphal split off from the original series.
It's a fan film.
Exactly. Yes, it's a multi-billion dollar film. No, it's not a fan film because J.J. Abrams already said he wasn't a fan until recently.
But Justin Lin is.
Well, good for Justin Lin. So I'm going to suspend my adjustment on that. But there's one other piece of information that I read about the new Star Trek series.
Sure.
That's the possibility that Nathan Fillion is going to be the new captain.
Nathan Fillion from Firefly.
From Firefly and from Dr. Horrible's...
Dr. Horrible's sing-along blog.
Exactly.
Captain Hammer.
And, you know, it would be interesting if they go all the way back and get retro with it and have a white male as the captain. If I could pick someone, though, I was telling you earlier, I would pick him as the Kirk surrogate. It's too bad that he wasn't young enough to play the Kirk surrogate in the J.J. Abrams universe, because I think he'd be a better Kirk than Chris Pine, but then you know my hatred of Chris Pine.
And he's kind of, and he's hot.
And he's hot. Well, that helps. But what I'm saying is he's got that kind of swagger.
Yes.
That kind of, well, you know, that's da-da-da. And he seems to be almost willing at any moment to be willing to parody himself. So he's almost pre-Shatnering Shatner by, like, right, being ahead of the curve and saying, I'm willing to do this show and not take it too seriously. So, you know, we'll see if that's true or if that's just another one of those wishes that turned into a hope that turned into a rumor.
I just want to compliment us.
Yes.
On the fact that although we do very little research on the show and take very few notes, we don't seem at a loss for... for verbiage, for dialogue.
No, there's no dead air. We're 44 episodes in, and there's never been dead air, except when we lose our cell phone signal and we don't know it.
Or like I have a brain fart, and I have to, like, you know, find that thought somewhere. Well, swirling around, right, in the millions in my head.
Well, thank God there's two of us, because one of us, that might happen. This is the nature of our relationship.
I think that also, one more Star Trek thing, it's possibly, again, speculation, which I love to do on the show, is that maybe Paramount doesn't want any bad blood out there with the fans in advance of the 50th anniversary of Star Trek, the big thing happening.
Which is coming this summer.
In August.
Right.
In Vegas.
There will be a big to-do. It's going to probably be the last time that all surviving original series members are together. Shatner will be there.
Yes.
And I don't think necessarily on the same day. I hope there is. There'll probably be this big surprise balloon drop kind of thing, but I know Terry Farrell's going to be there. I think Michael Dorn's going to be there. By the way, will it be like
the Saturday Night Live reunion where, right, they got every available person to show,
right,
up?
Right. Just a quick aside, there is a movement through Michael Dorn's webpage to get Worf back into the Star Trek universe in terms of TV or movies or whatever.
Huh. How would that work?
I don't know. And it will be interesting because if the Fuller series is in that time frame where it could be. Because remember, Michael Dorn played Worf's father in Star Trek VI at the Kittimer conference.
At Kittimer.
Because that's where his father dies. So maybe the pilot will be the attack on Kittimer.
Ah.
Ooh. I just suddenly thought that.
Well, I'm thinking more and more about that logo being very Klingon. And
a potential war, rift.
I'll just ask you an opinion. What is your opinion of the new font and the sort of the very brushed metal...
Right.
What do you call that thing?
The texture?
The gold. The gold.
The insignia.
The gold insignia. What do you think of it?
Well, it's interesting because the original insignia for what became known as Star Trek, the idea back in the original series was that each starship had its own insignia.
Nah.
So in the original series, you'll notice that when you go to a different colony or a different starship, they have different insignias,
right,
on their, you know, uniforms. And according to the Star Trek universe or Star Trek lore, the Enterprise was so successful in its 5-year mission that Starfleet simply took that dramatic swoosh, I think it's been called or whatever, and adopted it as the Starfleet insignia.
Ah.
So if you use that as your foundation, I'm glad they're staying they're still honoring it. They're still keeping it, you know. Abrams used it in all of his stuff. It's just become basically the symbol for Star Trek. I like that they're keeping with it. I like that they're willing to play with it. I think it's interesting that there's a line running down the middle of it.
What about that hash, that crisscross?
Oh, you mean the texturing
texture
of it?
Yeah.
I think that's foo-foo-y. That's just making it look cool.
Okay.
That is. I think that they wanted to make, I think... a metallic texture is going to connote something that's strong, firm, masculine, cool, not hot, but cool.
You know what else? Okay, I'm going Klingon again. You know what else I think is Klingon, references mm-hmm. Klingon, besides the design of the logo? And I know you asked your opinion, honey, but I just jumped in because I thought of something. The deep crosshatch pattern in that gold symbol is somewhat like the sash that the Klingons
Correct.
Wore, right?
Correct.
Right, right.
Yes.
So.
The sash that Worf wears on yes. Next Gen. So, yeah, I agree with you. I think the textures, I think nothing is done
by accident.
Right. Especially if Fuller is hinting at us that there are Easter eggs here, meaning that there are indications of where the Star Trek series is going to go. And I love that they're doing that so early. The font, now I need to start by saying, if those who may not have already listened to the show to know, I'm a font nerd. I was using Letraset scratch-off letters when I was like 10 to make my own little newsletter and things like that before I could do desktop publishing. I love fonts. I just am fascinated at the psychology.
Oh, Letraset was like magic. You just rub it and then
it
poof.
Yes, yeah. it was like scratch and sniff for font nerds. And so I love fonts. I'm always paying a lot of attention to them. When a font is wrong, it just bothers the shit out of me.
Or when people use multiple fonts on
wrong
one
fonts,
sign.
Multiple fonts, the wrong font to mean something else, sample the font wrong, think that this is a font that's this one. It's like, no, that's not actually the same font. Whatever.
And kerning and things
kerning
like that.
Drives me nuts. Kerning. I'm a kerning queen, okay? when I first looked at the Star Trek logo, I understood why people are like, that is that our new logo? But the more I've looked at it, the more I'm like, you know what? It's growing on me because I think it does have it harkens back. I will bet you, I would, if I could, I would just beg Brian to show me the samples of all the different possibilities. Cause you know, that's what they do.
Oh,
right. They come, the designers come in with 10, you know, possibilities or more.
Do you think they focus grouped it?
They may have focus grouped it. I don't know. I would love to know from Brian what kind of process went into that. How much input did he have? Who made the decision on design elements like that? Because Brian is so global in his appreciation of design and those little kind of details that matter, which is why all of his TV series are watchable. All his TV series have great details. All of his television productions, including his scripts, where he had executive producer, you know, power,
right,
have that attention to detail. So I don't think it's an accident at all. And I like the font now. I've come around. I'm like, okay, now I'm seeing maybe where it's going. Because the thing about font choices, and this is not just in Star Trek, this is in general, font choices, especially when it comes to logos or titles, have got to have a purpose. There's got to be real thinking behind them. There's got to be psychology. There's got to be period. Like when I'm watching a movie that's set in the 50s or the 30s or the 70s and somebody's carrying a newspaper, my eye immediately looks at it and goes, okay, the font's right.
Oh, right.
Half the time the fonts are too new. Or the fonts are self-consciously trying too hard to be from the period, you know, like we were talking about when we were watching The Americans the other night on television, going, one of the biggest mistakes that set designers make is when they're trying to do a series show that's supposed to be set in a specific period, they bring everything from that exact year. And it's like, no.
And people, no one's home is like that.
No, everyone's home is 5 to 10 years out of day, unless you're like super rich. So it's the same thing with fonts. And fonts are very closely tied to time frames and styles. Star Trek, the original logo of Star Trek, if you look, is very different from its very, very, very original ones. If you look up, if you Google the original Star Trek ads from TV Guide, or even, I think I've got it somewhere, a paperback book, the original font they had for Star Trek looked much closer to Lost in Space than that slick, leaning, sharp, futuristic font that ended up being the title
font. That arrowhead-looking thing.
Right. Correct. And then it went to something that was a little bit closer to what became the new. It went to a much more kind of microgramma, just this is the future, sans serif or whatever. And so that's my roundabout way of saying I think they've gotten it right. I just think that the fans have to be brought in and understand why that particular font. I don't think it's accidental and a mistake. I think what it is purposeful, and fans just have to either wait or figure out or both what the purposes are.
And I think I misspoke. When I said arrowhead, I was referring to the logo shape.
Right.
And now that I'm my head is filled with Klingon, I'm completely on board with the new logo and the new.
Well, yeah, look at the logo for the new Klingon font. Empire.
Yeah,
it's a very, very recognizable logo. The logo for the Romulan Empire, the bird, with like, you know, the one that I think that came about in Next Generation is when I think that came about. I don't think it came about in the movies because there weren't that many Romulan appearances in the movies. Is much, much more elaborate and much less effective because it's so busy. Whereas the simplicity of the Starfleet logo and the simplicity of the Klingon logo are very, very effective because the Klingon logo looks like it's a weapon.
Yes.
Like you can pick up the logo and hurt someone with it, right?
Right. So can you tell we love Star Trek?
A little bit.
A little bit. Moving on to something. We saw a movie recently, and we'll just get out of the way because we did promo it in our on our Facebook post.
Movie we waited to see. We didn't see it right
Yeah,
now.
We didn't rush out for this, and I'm actually kind of surprised that you went. Because,
why?
Well, based on... Because whenever we talk about comic book movies on this show...
Or we all get cranky.
Or even privately.
We get privately.
And you, even more... You didn't quite swear off of seeing them, but you were saying that it was a diminishing return.
What I will say is this, and I'm speaking from my point of view, not because I think we can talk about that. Those are okay. Let me start over. There are two different issues here. One is how do comic book movies appeal to me, just me? And the second thing is what's happening to comic book movies in general. What are they indicative of? Because they become such a powerhouse of making money and therefore also driving Hollywood into making choices as to what gets made and what they put, you know, their energy into. Those are two completely different issues, although there's probably a Venn diagram of where they cross. There may be one of the reasons that I don't like or I'm not as attracted anymore to comic book movies. It may have to do with my resentment for the fact that they're just becoming these kind of factories of pseudo-political intrigue and I think we talked about this previously, a misapplication of trying to shoehorn in deeper ideas and deeper thoughts and deeper psychology into something that's got much less it's got a much, much more simple foundation. And we're talking about comic books.
Right.
Not graphic novels. So yeah, that's I guess where I'm at now, if you will.
So Did we even say what we saw?
No, we haven't yet. What do you feel about comic book movies? Are you saying that you're more interested in seeing them than I am, or are you just saying, or are you just asking me?
I was just asking you, but since it was a conversation, I would say that, you know, it really depends. Even when I feel burned by something like, say, Batman versus Superman.
Which we're still brushing the charcoal away.
Yes. I still.
And everybody was burned by that movie. Everyone hates that movie.
I still
Even
feel.
Comic book fans hate that movie.
I still feel. I don't know. I still feel.
Do they still appeal to you?
Yes.
Well, let me ask you back.
And that's because I try to go in to, you know, by wiping the slate, not holding, mm-hmm. holding a misfire, the mm-hmm. previous misfire right. against the new film, which I have not seen.
Right. That's fair. Have you? I mean, you and I have talked a lot about what a perfect. Our nearly perfect movie, the original Superman, the movie is from the 70s with Chris Reeve.
Yes.
After that, were you a comic book movie fan?
No.
Okay.
I was not.
So you weren't like nuts about Superman 2 and 3 and 4, God forbid.
I wasn't nuts about...
You weren't craving movies that were comic book based?
I look forward to 2 because they brought everybody back.
Right. And it was being filmed during 1.
It was being... Yeah, so it's really... Almost like 1.2,
right?
Or 1.5, whatever you want to call it. And so, I wasn't disappointed. I really enjoyed 2. And then
I was.
Really?
A little. At the time, I liked it, but the more I thought about it,
and
more
then
I was
and then 3, I was like, oh, geez, what the
yeah,
talk about going off the rails.
Speak of it. And 4, we shouldn't even talk
and
about.
And then so yeah, so I stopped being interested in comic book movies until Batman.
Batman, the Tim Burton,
the
Batman.
Tim Burton okay. Batman, and I liked the sequel to that, and then I.
Which is better, I think, than the first Batman
right.
film.
And then, but no, I didn't, you know, I wasn't eagerly anticipating the next comic book movie. When they came along and I was entertained, I was like, oh, great. Well, that's cool. I'll keep it up in mind to the next one. Yeah, sure. Mm-hmm. Dark Knight really began this whole...
That's the beginning of the new era, I think. The new kind of period. That there was the Burton era, which was an extension kind of the original Superman film. But then we hit the Dark Knight Chris Nolan period, right?
Right. And then Iron Man came out soon.
Which
soon
I
after
liked
that.
More than I thought I would.
Oh, really?
Yes. When I first saw it, I was like, oh, wow, now this is what a superhero movie should be. And I remember loving the first Avengers movie. The first Avengers movie is fantastic.
Right.
I kept feeling like they just kind of kept going to the well and making the movie again.
Thor was okay. Spider-Man was okay. You know?
If I see one more city destroyed by alien X from planet Y, I'm just going to get up and leave because it's just the same, you know, epic battle at the end every time.
Well, we don't have much time to talk about Captain America: Civil War,
which is what we're talking about. Go ahead.
I liked it. I was entertained by it. I did not look at it. I didn't go too deeply at, you know, at some of the absurdities. I liked that. You got a bunch of the characters all in one movie. That's always fun, you know.
Uh-huh.
Spider-Man, he looks about 12.
Come on.
Spoiler alert, by
which
the
everybody
way.
Else seems to love, but you and I were just kind of like going, nah.
And it totally changed, you know, as a spoiler alert, they totally changed the whole Spider-Man origin story. He doesn't.
Which they don't even give you.
Ejaculate from his wrist.
No.
From
it's just
exposure to a
made.
Spider and radiation.
It's more like Batman. He created this device.
Yeah, they made it more like Batman.
But
except.
See,
go ahead.
Go ahead.
and then he has these eyes that narrow, for which I don't quite understand.
I don't know how
either.
Costumes' eyes can narrow. And I also noticed that it's kind of like, on the other hand, even though he's not been like radioactively spider bite changed, he still has some sort of superhuman ability to fly. Or is that just him using his web stuff?
Yes.
He seems to have super heroic muscle control power, if not strength.
And
so that works against itself.
And Spider-Man is still mortal, right? He's not.
I assumed, but then we assumed Wonder Woman was mortal or semi-mortal, although there's a hint that she's immortal. But let's not go back to that.
What did you think of the movie?
I thought it was fine for what it was supposed to be, but I also don't think it was the All the President's Men of the comic book movies, which is what I think it's trying to be. Or at least maybe that's what Winter Soldier was trying to be. Winter Soldier was trying to be a political drama.
They tried to make it deeper than it was.
I heard an interview with the directors of Winter Soldier and Avengers Civil War, and they talked about being influenced by the parallax view.
Oh, like the Warren Beatty thing?
70s political thriller. So I was like, oh, that explains it. You guys are really trying to make a 70s political thriller out of a comic book movie. And that's where I think I have a problem. And other people see it as being deeper than a comic book movie. It's
you
like,
know what? I don't remember the politics. I remember them kicking each other's asses on a playing field.
And the only other thing I would say that bothered me about the film is that this is a very technical thing. The framing of the fight sequences seem to be too tight and too close and too movement-oriented, so that as I was watching it, I was thinking, I wish I were watching this on DVD so I could be farther away and it have not be so big, because I couldn't track what was going on and where, and it was just – I just kept feeling disoriented in a way that was negative.
Well, the first half of the movie, whatever the frame rate they were using was really disoriented. It almost made me nauseous, and they kind of fixed it halfway through.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll be back from this short break, and then we got to wrap up really quick. This episode of Gay Nerd Love is brought to you by our friends at Second Look Scripts. Second Look Scripts is an independent, professional editing service to find plot holes, question character decisions, and break your writing down beat by beat. We know that you're a creative person because you're listening to this podcast. Why not take the next step with your script, novel, or erotic Babylon 5 fan fiction? Have your writing edited and proofread by Second Look Scripts for just a penny per word. That's it. Go to secondlookscripts.com and enter the offer code GNLPDX to get 10% off of your first edit. Go to secondlookscripts.com and make your writing stand out. Okay, we're almost done with the show.
This is what it's like to be around us. is what our podcast really is, a sampling of what we do, you know, when we're not doing it.
Quickly, our social media. Facebook, Gay Nerd Love on Facebook.
YouTube, we have a channel that has videos that are all about each episode, so we have different playlists and plus stuff we also post. We also have a Twitter account.
At Gay Nerd Love.
And all of this can be found, of course, on gaynerdlove.com. And you can leave a review for us and download episodes of our podcast on iTunes. So, there, we got through that fast.
Okay. So, well, until next time.
Until next time.
I gaynerd love you, Andy.
I gaynerd love you, Archie.
Oh, yeah. Come here. Gay Nerd Love is a project of Bad Maria Productions.